Ocular structures affected by the disease. It's the possibility of picking up early structural changes at the ganglion cell layer and retinal nerve fiber layer have made it a very exciting tool to pick up early pre-perimetric glaucoma or to detect early changes or progression in established cases of glaucoma. The current generation of spectral domain OCT is able to provide a huge volume of data which is collected over a very short period of time over a larger scan area with better resolution and repeatability as compared to the previous generation of time domain OCTs. It is also claimed by Cirrus that they autocorrect for tough anatomic situations like peripapillary atrophy and tilted discs which frequently coexist in glaucoma patients. The spectral domain marks the edge of the disc as the edge of the RPE in OptiView and the edge of the Bruch's membrane in Cirrus, and thereby it outlines the optic disc. The optic disc centration makes it possible to center the RNFL calculation concentric to the disc at a radius of 3.45 millimeters, and this has reduced the fallacies due to wrong scan placement. Another advantage is that you have the baseline 3D OCT scan that gets registered, so subsequent tests can be done at the same location, and you have a test-retest variability that is lesser than a mind-numbing figure of 1 micron. Although time domain and spectral domain perform equally well for differentiating normal from glaucoma eyes, the main advantage of spectral domain lies in its tight scan registration and resolution. So progression analysis is a much better thing with the spectral domain. Also, because the range of normal is very large, it's probably a better idea to assess change from the patient's own baseline scans vis-a-vis comparing with a large variation in the normal population. What is now important is that we educate ourselves about this technology to make sense of the report that is in front of us, to understand the inherent shortcomings of the technology, and to avoid caution in labeling the disease as a red or a green OCT. It is important not to underestimate the importance of a thorough clinical evaluation, because that is something you can probably rely on, since software can at times fail. Do not compare values of different OCT machines. They have different algorithms. Now, the retinal nerve fiber layer is depicted in terms of a thickness map, in terms of an RNFL calculation circle, and in terms of a signal profile or a TSNIT graph. All values in the OCT are color-coded green, yellow, and red, depending upon the percentage probability of falling within 95%, less than 5%, or outside in the 1% range of normals. The RNFL analysis is averaged for total hemisphere-wise as well as sector-wise, and it's better to pick up focal defects in the sector analysis, which may be missed in the average values. Also, look out at the profile. Sometimes a head tilt may cause a very aberrant kind of a signal profile. Typically, you will have a double hump pattern. Remember that disc size and axial length would affect measurements, and in discs that fall outside this range, you may not put much value on the comparison with normals. Do look out for the isn't rule, and remember that an inferior average is the best way to discriminate healthy from glaucomatous eyes. Do not underestimate the importance to the retinal thickness map. Sometimes you'll pick up changes here which are not reflected in the average RNFL. Numbers, though important, can be misleading. Do not go by numbers. Remember that intraocular pressure can affect the RNFL thickness, so whatever scans you have to start with, you need to repeat them fairly often to get a good baseline scan, which is important for assessing progression. And you need to reset this baseline every time you have a new target pressure or say you operate the patient for glaucoma or cataract. The ganglion cell complex is studied at the macula in a 7 square millimeter scan area, and for the optoview, it includes the nerve fiber layer, the inner plexiform layer, and the ganglion cell layer, while the serous does not include the NFL in its calculations. It is depicted as a thickness map. Typically, you have this ring pattern around the fovea. The deviation from normal is shown in the deviation map, color-coded blue or black, depending upon the percentage of from normal. And the significance map will show the probability or statistical significance of this deviation as being relevant. The parameters of global and focal loss volume are used to average the global or focal loss over the GCC map. And the advanced glaucoma imaging study has concluded that the FLV is the single best predictor of conversion. So if you have an FLV in the red, you have a 4 times greater risk of developing field damage in the next 6 years. Now, this is a normal ONH report showing optic disc parameters, the RNFL parameters. Do always look at the symmetry analysis. Usually, an inter-eye symmetry is less than 12 microns difference. And this is the comprehensive map showing the ONH as well as the GCC and the parameters on the right-hand side. Now, what's important when you read a scan is that you should understand, is it a reliable scan, and then whether the data collected, how do you interpret it, how relevant it is. The most important thing to look out for reliability is the signal strength index, and any scan which has values less than, say, 45 in the optoview should not even be read into any further, because it would give you a falsely low interpretation of the RNFL. And the avoidable factors are that you must make sure the eyes are well lubricated, and that if required, the pupils should be dilated in the presence of, say, some cataract. See that the scan is well centered, because horizontally or vertically deviated scans are going to affect the RNFL measurement. See that the scan is again placed well for the GCC and not abnormally as is there in this patient. So your operator should be well trained, because a lot of times when you have the report, you don't have the raw image to correlate with. So the operator should be trained to either repeat the scan when you have a situation like this, and also to put in their notes, relevant notes, so that you interpret them. And if you have a finding which is not correlating very well, you must go to the machine and look up the raw data, see how it was collected. It will give you an idea how much relevance to place on the report. Even a small head tilt can affect the position of the sector loss. Look out in the raw image for any blinking, for any eye movement, for any media opacities. See that the scan's well centered in the scan window, and that it's not inverted or that it's not misplaced. This can give you a false interpretation. Sometimes the software algorithm is going to consider some other optically reflective structure as the RNFL edge, say the posterior vitreous phase or the epiretinal membrane. So in these patients, you may have a segmentation error. Even sometimes you may have a segmentation error without any such cause. So do see that the lines are placed measuring the structure that you have to evaluate. Be cautious in interpreting patients with peripapillary atrophy and high myopes. And remember, there is a floor effect in RNFL. So when you have advanced glaucoma and the RNFL has fallen off below 45 microns, it's unlikely to really fall much further. And you should assess the patient by means of functional tests. The pattern of the GCC is also important. Usually you would have an arcuate kind of a defect, and in an advanced glaucoma it would form a red donut. And if you have any abnormal kind of a GCC appearance, do a macular scan, because very frequently you will find that there is some confounding associated macular pathology. In these patients, the GCC is not very relevant for the glaucoma checkup. Self-explanatory but still important, always correlate with visual fields and clinical disc assessment, and see that it correlates. That helps to give you a further confirmation of the diagnosis. And in the fellow eyes, very frequently you will see that you have a GCC or an RNFL that is aberrant with normal visual fields. Surprisingly, you may also have a normal OCT in patients of glaucoma, and it is said that this could be that the patient may not fall outside the so-called normal range, or that you have a very deep focal defect that doesn't get picked up in the average or a sector evaluation, or that the diffuse component is too large and it masks a localized defect. Always remember that you are comparing to a normative database. And this normative database is not very extensive, not as extensive as we would like it to be. The most important advantage of spectral domain is to assess progression, and this progression is defined as a change outside expected variability and is evaluated both as an event as well as studied over a period of time. It gives you the trend analysis, and the trend is very important in picking up the rate of progress in a patient, so you can assess whether they are fast progressors or they are fairly stable. This progression may happen at the GCC or at the RNFL. The order of progression or structural damage varies in patients. And you have to assess it both on the image progression to pick up deep narrow focal defects, on the TSNIT progression to evaluate shallow broader focal defects, and diffuse defects are best picked up on the average RNFL loss. So this is the, you can scan in the OptoView up to 4 scans at a time, and you can look out at the thickness, the numbers, the profile, and the change over a period of time. And in this map, you can see that you have the donut, which is increasing. The cirrus color codes it yellow when it's 5% off from baseline, and if it's consistently present, it shows it as a red. And to correlate all the findings, I'll just tell you, without going into the details, I'll say that the anterior segment OCT also has some potential in glaucoma. Its use is there for assessing the CCT, for assessing the angle, especially in dynamic or low light situations, to assess the PI being full thickness, and also to assess the trabeculectomy site, the bleb morphology, and to see that the tube is patent and where is it placed. And in the near future, we look forward to the swept source OCT assessing the lamina cribrosa and making us understand the disease pathology better, and for the Doppler measurement of retinal blood flow. Thank you very much, and I hope that the OCT is basically a piece in the puzzle which we need to piece together to assess clinically what to do with a patient of glaucoma, and it should always be used in correlation with all other available findings, both functional as well as whatever you are evaluating clinically. Thank you.